Hello friends, welcome back. Myself Pushpender Singh, and we are going to start with our current affairs. So today you have 8th of May 2021, right? And these lectures are basically based on the current affairs. For that you should also study the national newspapers like the Hindu or Indian Express. You can refer any of these newspapers, and apart from that you can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures. So these lectures are uploaded on the YouTube on the day-to-day basis, so you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube for these lectures. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first news is related to the National Financing Reporting Authority. Okay, so National Financing Reporting Authority is nothing but a regulatory body, right? Now the news is coming out related to the reporting of the financial, you know, database, right, related to the companies and the auditors, right? So the news is something which is says that the National Financing Reporting Authority have prepared a database, right, for the companies as well as the auditors, right, for the purpose of finding any sort of irregularities or for the purpose of greater regulatory oversight over these authorities as companies and auditors, right? So regarding this National Financing Reporting Authority, as I told you that the National Financing Reporting Authority is a regulatory body, right, which has been set up, right, as under the Companies Act. So it has been set up under Section 132 of the Company Act. The main objective of setting up this National Financing Reporting Authority is to oversee the compliance, right, related to the accounting and auditing standards which are adopted by the companies, right, as these companies are declared or described as a public interest entities, right? So to have the greater oversight over related to the compliance related mechanism with respect to the accounting and auditing standards that the company adopted. For that purpose, a regulatory body called National Financing Reporting Authority have been set up. Okay, so this group basically consisting of the listed companies as well as last unlisted companies. So what is the main duties of the NFRA or National Financing Reporting Authority? See, the main duties of the National Financing Reporting Authority is to recommend some accounting and auditing policies as well as the standards that has to be adopted by the companies, right? Definitely for the approval by the central government. Okay, now the second most important objective of setting up of this NFRA is to monitor and enforce the compliance with accounting standards, right, as well as the auditing standard that have been adopted by the companies, right, and also to oversee the quality of service of the professionals, right, the professionals which are associated with all such professions, right? So you can understand that to oversee their services related to the professionals with respect to those standards, as well as simultaneously propose certain measures for the improvement of the quality of service, right? The last most important objective is, right, to perform such other functions that are needed for fulfilling its responsibility. So for that purpose, it has prepared a provisional database for the companies and the auditors for fulfilling its objectives. All right, now the one thing that is coming to your mind is that what is this this listed companies and unlisted companies that will be coming to your mind. Now you must understand the term called listed, right? The term called listed, that is in the economic parlay, you can say that the company that is included, right, or on which is basically included on the given stock exchange, right, so that its stock exchange can be traded. So the companies, or most of the companies, they tend to prefer to be listed on the major stock exchanges, right? Like you have like the major stock exchange, like New York Stock Exchange or NYSE or NASDAQ, right? So why they want to listed on the major stock exchange, so that they could provide, you know, the most liquidity and the visibility for the company's stock, right? And that will be beneficial for those companies also. All right. Right, and to discharge this mandate that I have told you, the objectives, the NFRA basically is in the process of creating this database of the companies and the auditors, right, which comes under its regulatory ambit of the National Financing Reporting Authority, right? So this database, which will be set up by the National Financing Reporting Authority, this database will involve or would also have certain other steps, right? Like the identification, the verification of the primary data source, right? Reconciliation of the data, right? With respect to the company's identification number, right? As well as from different sources, these data will be collected, right? So the NFRA or National Financing Reporting Authority would be involving National Financing Reporting Authority would be involving or engaging with some other database like the Corporate Data Management Division of the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, right? As well as the three recognized stock exchange that is available in terms of India in order to find out the data as well as to have the greater oversight, the regulatory oversight over these companies and the auditors, right? So here the provisional database of the companies and their auditors, right, which have been compiled by the National Financing Reporting Authorities as of 31st March 2019. This is already been published on the website of the National Financing Reporting Authority. You could go to that website and you could check it out. Okay. Now this provisional data, which has been collected by the National Financing Reporting Authorities and already published on the website, that will be updated and revised, right, over the period of the time, right, as and when the data will be collected and the information that will be collected based on the new data, right? So here the exercise for the compilation of the data, right, for updating of the data will be undertaken under the ambit of National Financing Reporting Authority with respect to the companies as well as auditors. Okay, the next is foam path. Now you must understand the foam path here, I mean here is that the certain foam which will be applied on the runways in the airport, right? So that in the case of emergency landing, right, because of the traction or because of, you know, the friction, the aircraft does not catch the fire, right? Because you must understand, as and when there is emergency landing on the runway, right, because of either the landing gear do not open or because of some sort of a valley landing, right, then what happens is because of this friction, because directly the body of the plane will be directly, you know, dragging all around the runways, or sometime what happens is there is some problem with the landing gear, so the landing gear would come directly in the contact with, you know, with the runway, and that basically causes the friction, and that may basically, you know, leaks out certain, you know, the fluid from say from the tank of the aircraft or some other, you know, explosive fluid may come out, and that friction may cause, you know, the fire in the aircraft. So in order to stop that, right, you know, a foam path is created on the runway so that the plane can swiftly glide, right, without catching the fire on the path or on the runway. So here one such incident occurred at the Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj International Airport in Mumbai, right, where a plane, right, called BTGIL aircraft, which is smaller aircraft, has made a belly landing, right, when it's, you know, the landing gear has refused to open, right? So what happens is at that point of the time, the officials from the Airport Authority of India, basically what they have done, they have applied the foam on the surface of the runway so that it could not catch a fire. So foam path is nothing but a aviation safety practice, right, of spreading certain layer of fire suppression foam. This fire suppressants are basically applied on the runway, right, prior to the emergency landing so that this does not catch the fire, right? Now what is this fire suppression foam? Now you must understand the foam which is used here in the form of, you know, the purple K, which is basically a dry chemical, right? What is this purple K? The purple K is basically the dry chemical fire suppressant agent, right, which is basically used as a dry chemical fire extinguishers, right? So it is basically, you know, the most effective, right, the dry chemical extinguisher, which is basically comes, you know, as the most effective, right, in terms of the second most effective fire extinguisher after the potassium allophenate. Okay, so purple K or PKP is basically a fire suppressant dry chemical agent, right, which is being used by the airport authorities in order to extinguish the fire on the runways. Okay, now what happens is it is basically 4 to 5 times more effective, right, as the carbon dioxide, right? We also use the carbon dioxide as well as sometimes we also use the sodium bicarbonate also in order to extinguish the fire, right? But this is chemical which is a dry form of purple K, which will be very effective for that purpose. Okay, now as you know that the following of the crash landing, like what happens is during that point of the time, right, from the aircraft, some liquids that may have either, you know, the aviation fuel or some other liquids may come out of the aircraft. Now that what happens is they started evaporating, and this evaporation basically caused some sort of an air vapor mixture, which is again very, very volatile and very, very inflammable. And it is also very highly explosive. Suddenly it causes a fire, right? And suddenly it can cause an explosion that you might have also observed, okay, in the videos. So this extinguishing form in the form of purple K would definitely prevent this air vapor mixture or this formation of this air vapor mixture, right? So this form is basically applied on the runway as a carpet, as a foam carpet, which will act as a vapor barrier, right? So here, in order to secure this emergency landing, we generally apply this dry form of fire extinguisher, right, which will suppress this sparking and the burning of any aircraft metals due to, you know, either friction on the runway surfaces. All right, so here you can see this aircraft, this is the original scene where this aircraft have glide over this foam surface. This is what is basically the dry form of the purple K, which was the dry, you know, the fire extinguisher basically, which was applied on the runway so that it could not catch the fire. All right. Next, the Pune Metro Rail project. Now you must understand the Pune Metro Rail project is something which is related to the metro rail construction in the Pune city of Maharashtra. So the Pune Metro Rail project is being funded by the European Investment Bank. So around 600 million euros, right, of the loan have been approved, right, from the European Investment Bank for the purpose of the Pune Metro Rail project. So total 600 million euros. Now, right, certain 200 million euros have already been coming, already has come to the Pune Metro Rail project, and now further, the next 150 million euros of, you know, for the purpose of the Pune Metro Rail project would be coming, right, through a financial contract which is being signed between the Government of India as well as the European Investment Bank. So both Government of India and European Investment Bank both have signed a financial contract for the next 150 million euro for the purpose of the construction of Pune Metro Rail project next phase. So this financial contract has been signed through a virtual signing ceremony. The total loan which is being provided by the European Investment Bank is around 600 million euros. Now, let us understand brief about the European Investment Bank. See, European Investment Bank is basically the European Union's investment bank, which is owned by the European Union member states. There are 27 European Union member states, which is owning this European Investment Bank. So you can say it is one of the largest, right, you know, supranational lenders in the world. Okay, it has been headquartered at Luxembourg, and it has been founded in 1958. Okay, so the already one finance contract which was signed previously between Government of India and European Investment Bank for the purpose of providing this 200 million euro for the Pune Metro Rail project have already been signed, right, on 27th, 2019, right? And the main purpose of this project is to provide the efficient, safe, economic and pollution free mass rapid system in the form of the metro connectivity, specifically in the Pune, right, in order to decongest the traffic in the city, right? And the Maharashtra Metro Rail Corporation Limited, which will be the implementing agency for the purpose of this project. Here you can see the Maharashtra Metro, which is being looks like this. Okay, next, pitch siding. What is pitch siding? So first let us understand the news, then we'll understand what is pitch siding, right? So what happens is, as you know that Indian Premier League or IPL, right, matches are going on, right? And in that, the pitch siding was basically, you know, happens. And now what happens is, an anti-corruption unit belong to the BCCI have arrested the two individuals for the purpose of the pitch siding, right, with siding or court siding. Now, why the BCCI's anti-corruption unit have arrested or nabbed these two individuals, which are basically, you know, located inside, you know, basically your stadium, right? So the point is that the pitch siding is basically, you know, a process or is an activity that if someone is present inside the sport venue, right? And if that person basically, you know, passes some information or some crucial information prior to relay that information to the viewers. For example, there is some, you know, seconds lag between the real occurring of the events as well as the, you know, the relay of that event to the basically viewers. So sometime what happens is this 10 second, 5 second or 20 seconds delay in terms of the relay of this particular event can cause the substantial, you know, profit to certain individual in terms of this betting or sports betting. So certain individuals are involved in the sports betting or betting event, right? So in that purpose, they usually bet based on that information called pitch siding, right? So there the information is being received, right, from the person which is basically located inside the sports venue, and that person will pass out that information to the bookies, and that information will be used as a part of accepting or rejecting this sports bet in the sense of a sport. Now you have to understand this sport betting, right, in a detail manner. So I'll give you an example, but before you must understand what is this Indian Premier League, IPL. Everybody would have heard about this IPL, but IPL, you must understand, IPL is basically a professional 2020 cricket league. So IPL is a professional 2020 cricket league which is contested by the 8 teams, right? These 8 teams are basically based out of the 8 different Indian cities, right? You have like Rajasthan, Mumbai, right? And you have Hyderabad, like different types of cities which are involved, right? Now this league are basically founded by the Board of Control for the Cricket in India in 2007. Okay, that is BCCI. Now let us understand brief about the BCCI also. See, BCCI, the full form is Board of Control for the Cricket in India, is basically a governing body for the cricket in India. It is currently under the jurisdiction of the Ministry of Youth Affairs and the Sports Government of India. The BCCI is formed in December 1928 as a society which is registered under Tamil Nadu Society Registration Act. Okay, so this is what you must understand regarding this news. Now let us understand this pitch siding somewhat in more detail. Now you must understand that pitch siding is something which is related to the lag of the event, of related to some event which has been really occurred, but there is some lag of airing that event, right, in terms of the relay to the basically viewers of the television, right? So that time or that lag of 5 seconds, 10 seconds or 20 seconds may benefit certain sports betting persons, right, who generally put the bet on certain events of the sport, and they basically grab huge amount of money in that process. So definitely it is not, you know, as par with the match fixing, but definitely it has certain, you know, certain effect on the credibility of the, you know, the sports. So whatever, you can take an example. For example, if the delivery status or if the delivery result, I just give you an example, right? If a delivery results in a boundary, right? For example, if there is a 20 second lag on the television, there is a lag always. It is not something that whatever is actually occurring on the field that is being delivered to you exactly on the same time. Sometime that may happen that there are 5 second delay or 20 second delay or 10 seconds delay. So for example, if there is a delivery on the real field, say 4 runs, right? And if there is a delay of say 20 seconds on relaying on this television, now what happens is, right, this bookie or this basically, you know, the person who are exactly present on the sports venue, they will pass this information to the bookie that there is a boundary. Now the person who received this information can basically claim that it's not a boundary, right? It's not a boundary, right? What happens is that other person knows the information that it is a boundary. So what happens is they put a bat, right? And that accepting or rejecting the bat based on that boundary or based on that either the wide ball or wicket or 4 runs, 6 runs, 2 runs, whatever it may be, they put the bat, okay? And some information, they put the bat and they claim that this is not a real incident. And that is what is going to happen because that is a lag and that exact incidents had already occurred. And that lag would provide an opportunity to the bookie to put a bet on the real incident that has already occurred. So that gives an opportunity, right, for the financial return that the person can get it out of this information, right? So that is basically your, you know, that is called pitch siding. I hope it is very, very clear. All right, fine. Next. Puducherry. As you know, the Puducherry is basically a union territory, belongs to the Union of India. Okay. Now you must understand the Puducherry, right? Recently the elections have been held and the Prime Minister Narendra Modi have congratulated N. Rangasamy, right, who has recently taken as the oath of the Chief Minister of Puducherry. Now you must understand the Puducherry is basically a union territory. It is not a state, it is not a full-fledged state. That means the governance and administration responsibility vested with the federal authority or the central government. But Puducherry has the state legislature with them. So currently, only 3 union territories has the state legislature, right, which has been, you know, also has, you know, the state CM also. So only 3 union territories has the legislative assembly. The legislative assembly, along with that, a council of ministers headed by chief minister. So only three union territory has this. Otherwise, all other union territory has some other governing feature. So these union territories are basically the National Capital Territory of Delhi, National Capital Territory of Jammu and Kashmir, and the Pondicherry. These are the 3 union territories which are having the elected legislative assemblies as well as the council of ministers, which is headed by the chief minister in that particular union territory, right? So definitely they have certain special constitution amendment to get elected this the members of the constituent assembly the legislative assembly. And there is also the council of ministers, or you can say the cabinet ministers, definitely, which is headed by the prime minister, the chief minister in that particular union territory, right? Regarding some news about the Pondicherry, so Pondicherry Representative Assembly have been converted into the Legislative Assembly of the Pondicherry on the 1st July 1963 as per the Section 54 Clause 3 of the Union Territory Act 1963. Okay, now the elections for the Pondicherry Vidhan Sabha has held since 1965 and it is continuously, right, the members of the Legislative Assembly, or the term for the Legislative Assembly is 5 years. That means it can be dissolved earlier also, but normal term for the membership of this legislative assembly is 5 years, just like a normal term, right? And this legislative assembly, along with that, the union territory of Pondicherry also has the council of ministers, which has been headed by, you know, your chief minister. So currently the N. Rangasamy, which have held, right, or which have taken the oath of the chief minister of the Pondicherry. Now let us understand brief about N. Rangasamy. So N. Rangasamy is basically an Indian politician who is currently the chief minister of the union territory of Pondicherry, right? The N. Rangasamy previously, you know, previously was basically with the Indian National Congress, right? So he was basically also served as a chief minister of Pondicherry, say from 2001 to 2008, when he was the member of Indian National Congress. Now what happens is subsequently he formed his political party, right, which was known as All India, right, N. Rangasamy Congress, that is All India NR Congress. And now currently he is basically the chief minister from that political party, right? Next, the Vidhyanchal Thermal Power Station. Now Vidhyanchal Thermal Power Station, what is thermal power station? That is the power station where the power is generated from the coal. So it is being generated from the coal as a raw material, right? So here, as you know, that the Vidhyanchal Thermal Power Station is the largest coal-fired power station in the world, in the India. Okay, it is the largest coal-fired power station in the India. Okay, this Vindhyanchal Thermal Power Station belongs to NTPC or National Thermal Power Corporation, which is a Maharatna company, belongs to the government of India. Okay, now, as you know that because of COVID-19 pandemic, this NTPC plant, which is located in the Vidhyanchal, right, has also facing this heat of this COVID-19 pandemic. Several of its, you know, its employees getting, you know, the COVID-19, you know, infections. Now, what happens is this NTPC Vindhya Hospital, which is also located in the proximity of the NTPC power plant, which is located in the Vidhyanchal, right, has also treating the COVID-19 infected employees, right, in this hospital. So, regarding the Vidhyanchal thermal power station, it is located in the Singrauli district of Madhya Pradesh, okay, and it is one of the, you know, the coal-fired power station belongs to the NTPC. It is the largest power station in India and ninth largest power station in the world. Okay, the current capacity or current installed capacity of that plant is 4760 megawatt of electricity, right? It is being fired on the coal. So this coal is basically sourced from the Negahi mines. This Negahi mines, okay, these Negahi mines are basically the open cast mine. They are basically located or situated in the Singrauli district of Madhya Pradesh itself. So it's a part of the Singrauli coal field, or you can say they are form a part of Singrauli coal field. So this Negahi open cast coal mine is basically, you know, operated by the Northern Coal Field Limited. The Northern Coal Field Limited is a basically subsidiary of the Coal India Limited, which is again a PSU. Okay. And the water for this plant is sourced from the discharge canal from the Singrauli Super Thermal Power Station. Okay. From this 4760 megawatt of installed energy, right, the states which are benefited out of this plant are the Madhya Pradesh, Gujarat, Maharashtra, Goa, Chhattisgarh, Daman and Diu, Dadra and Nagar Haveli. Okay, so here you can see the Vidhyanchal thermal power plant, which is basically currently having the 4760 megawatt of installed capacity. Okay, next, the role of civil society in the COVID. So many civil society organizations or many NGOs have come forward to donate, right, 50,000 oxygen concentrators, right? These 50,000 oxygen concentrators would be donated in the month of May nationally by three, you know, NGOs that are called ACT Grants, Swasth Alliance and the Feeding India. All three NGOs are involved in donating of this 50,000 oxygen concentrators, right, nationwide in the month of May. So now let us understand, first of all, here you know that oxygen concentrators would definitely help in the scale up of the oxygen availability in terms of the shortage of the oxygen which is currently there in the hospitals of, you know, across the various states, right? So this ACT Alliance is basically the non-profit movement which has been created by the startup community in India, right, which is also a part of this donation of this 50,000 oxygen concentrators nationally. Second is basically the Swasth Alliance. The Swasth Alliance is also not for profit organizations, which is basically, you know, created by the healthcare organizations. Around 150 plus healthcare organizations are involved in the formation of this Swasth Alliance or the NGO. And the third is Feeding India. The Feeding India is basically the non-for-profit run by the Zomato, right? By the Zomato, everybody, you know, right? So all three non-for-profit organizations are committed themselves to provide or to donate around 50,000 oxygen concentrators for the purpose of scaling up of the oxygen availability in the country. So now let us understand what is this oxygen concentrator. See, oxygen concentrators are basically devices. It's simply they are device. So what is this concentration means? See, concentrated oxygen from the ambient air, right? So what this oxygen concentrators help? These oxygen concentrators help to concentrate the oxygen from the ambient air. How would they help it? They basically remove the nitrogen and they deliver the pure oxygen to the individual, right? You know, whose blood oxygen level have drops down below 93%, right? So that is to the patients whose oxygen level have dropped down to 93, right? These oxygen concentrators would definitely help the basically patients to provide, you know, the oxygen availability. So oxygen concentrators is basically a device that concentrate the oxygen from the gas supply, right? So typically the ambient air you take and such oxygen concentrators basically selectively remove the nitrogen, right? Right, basically to supply an oxygen enriched product gas stream to the basically to the patients. Okay, so here the oxygen concentrators will be donated across the country free of cost, largely to the various public health institutions as well as the NGOs which are working throughout the country. Okay, and this oxygen concentrators will be donated within the month of May to basically deal this second wave of COVID-19 pandemic. Okay, next, the vaccine delivery by the drones. Now you must understand, drones are also known as the unmanned aerial vehicles or UAV. They are also known as UAV or unmanned aerial vehicles. Now the Ministry of Civil Aviation and the Director General of Civil Aviation both have granted a conditional exemption, right, to the government of Telangana for conducting the experiment or the trial for the purpose of delivering the vaccines, right, for conducting this experiment, that is beyond visual line of sight drone flight delivery of the vaccines across the state. So here the exemption have been provided to such, you know, uses of these drones for this purpose, and exemptions basically is provided under the unmanned aircraft system rules 2021 that has been granted as a part of the government of India's push to enhance the availability and the scope of the drones for the purpose of the delivery of these vaccines nationwide for the purpose of mitigating this COVID-19 pandemic, right? So here, what is Directorate General of Civil Aviation? You must understand that one. Directorate General of Civil Aviation is a basically a statutory body, right, which has been set up under aircraft bill. This Directorate General of Civil Aviation basically investigate the aviation incidents, or it also maintain all regulations related to the aviation, and they are also responsible for issuance of license. So that is why the Director General of Civil Aviation is basically concerned with those license also, right? So here, the last month, the government of Telangana have also been granted the conditional exemption, right, for conducting this experiment for the, you know, for the visual line of sight, right, using the drones for the purpose of the COVID-19 vaccines delivery. Now to accelerate this deployment, now the government of Telangana is going to conduct an experiment for the purpose of beyond visual line of sight, you know, experiment or a trial for the purpose of delivering of these vaccines across the state, right? So it has been conditionally, exemption have been given, right, to the government of Telangana, and that trial may commence by the end of May 2021, okay? And this exemption will be provided only for the period of 1 year, right, from the date of approval or until further order, whichever is earlier granted, okay? And as you know that, as I have also informed you in my previous lectures also, that the 20 such consortia was already granted the permission for the purpose of this visual or beyond visual line of sight experimental trials with the use of the drone for the purpose of the delivery of the vaccines, right? So 20 such consortia has also been granted this permission or this conditional exemption for the purpose of uses of the drones for the purpose of delivery, right? So this beyond visual line of sight experimental trial will definitely help to create a regulatory framework, right, for the purpose of the drone availability, the drone delivery, as well as other applications where the drones are having the similar application for the purpose of delivery of different types of goods and the services to the needy customers. All right, so here you can see the drones are basically carrying out a vaccine. Then COVID Weave. Okay, so COVID Weave is basically a system or a device which is developed by the Department of Atomic Energy in collaboration with IIT Hyderabad, that is Indian Institute of Technology Hyderabad, right, as well as the ESIC Medical College, which is also located in Hyderabad. So the COVID Weave is basically a system or a device which is currently being developed by IIT Hyderabad along with the Department of Atomic Energy. So Union Minister of Atomic Energy Dr. Jitendra Singh have launched this COVID Weave to supplement the COVID infrastructure to fight this COVID-19 pandemic across the country. Okay, so it is India's first indigenous cost-effective wireless psychological parameters monitoring system. What is this psychological parameter monitoring system? That you must understand. So first of all, let us understand briefly about this psychological parameters monitoring system that will be monitored with the help of this COVID Weave system, which is being developed by the prestigious institution called IIT Hyderabad along with the Department of atomic energy. So what is this COVID beep? See, COVID beep is basically the beep COVID, as you know, see, that is a full form is called the continuous oxygenation and vital information detection biomed ECIL ESIC pod, right? That is basically the full form of this device. COVID VEEP is basically where it is India's first wireless physiological parameters monitoring system for the COVID-19 pandemic. So what is this physiological parameters? So first of all, you must understand the physiological parameters basically is something which is related to the person's effectively taken care of his physiological parameters, like so it will be help in reduction of certain set of the stress across the patients, right? So here you can understand this latest version of COVID VEEP, which is being incorporated, right? What the COVID VEEP will do in terms of the physiological parameters. So here you must understand the affected aged patients or the patients which are affected with the COVID-19 pandemic, especially the aged patients, right, which is having the highest rate of the mortality, right? So this VEEP would definitely monitor, right, this imperative in the context of these aged parameters, right, in terms of their physiological conditions, right? And it will also have the effect on the heart, right, as well as it will also help in the importance of the ECG monitoring, which will also be help in terms of the ECG monitoring, as well as it will also help in the respiratory rate, right? So here the respiratory rate will also be calculated indirectly. So COVID VEEP will definitely reduce the transmission risk, as well as, you know, it will help further the medical practitioners to basically help the patients in order to recover from COVID-19 pandemic. So it has the four important tasks. First is the NIBP monitoring. Okay. Second is basically the ECG monitoring. Okay. The third is basically your respiratory rate monitoring. And basically these three important components that will be clubbed together in the latest version of COVID VEEP that is being developed by IIT Hyderabad with the collaboration of Department of Atomic Energy. All right. Then Kawasura Kudineer. See, Kawasura Kudineer is also a drug apart from the Ayush 64, right? So the Kawasura Kudineer is basically a drug that will be given to the COVID-19 affected patients. So here the Ministry of Ayush is basically launching the drug distribution campaign, right, specifically with respect to the Ayush 64 as well as the Kawasura Kudineer drug for the purpose of the patients which are infected with the COVID-19 pandemic, right? So this efficacy of these drugs of both Ayush 64 as well as the Kawasura Kudineer have been proven by the clinical trials which have been held at the various centers of the Ministry of Ayush. So this Kawasura Kudineer is basically a Siddha medicine, right, which are given, right, to the patients by the Central Council of Research in the Siddha under the Ministry of Ayush. And this has proved clinically that the Siddha medicine called Kawasura Kudineer is effective in terms of the treatment of the COVID-19 affected patients, right? So what is this Central Council for the Research in the Siddha? As you know, the Central Council for the Research in Siddha is basically an apex body which is basically related to the research in terms of the Siddha system of medicine. Okay, so the Central Council for the Research in Siddha or CCRS is working toward the scientific validation of the Siddha system of the medicine through the clinical research, drug research, medicinal plant research, fundamental research, as well as the documentation related to the Siddha medicine. Right? What is Ministry of Ayush? As already you know, Ministry of Ayush basically is the short form for the Ministry of Ayurveda, Yoga, Naturopathy, Yunani Siddha and Sova Requiem Homeopathy. So it is a basically, you know, the Indian system of medicine, right? So the Ministry of Ayush is created by the government of India for the purpose of the developing education, research and propagation of this indigenous alternative medicine system in India. And that will definitely help in combating certain life-threatening diseases in terms of India also. So here the Ayush 64, it is also the drug which is recommended by, you know, by the government of India or Ministry of Ayush for the purpose of the patients which are recovering from COVID-19. Right. So certain clinical trials are also finding very effective in terms of using this Ayush 64 as a drug, right? So which is basically can be used with this COVID-19 patients in the home isolation, right? And this Kavasura Kodineer is also included in the guidelines of the Siddha practitioners for the COVID-19, right? And this Siddha practitioners can now prescribe this Kavasura Kodineer, right, as a drug for the purpose of, you know, recovering for those patients who are infected with the COVID-19 infections. All right. So here you can see the Kavasura Kodineer, right? It is the drug which will looks like this. Okay. All right. So that's all for today. Thank you very much. We'll meet again tomorrow for our next current affairs. Thank you.